Okay, now I'm very pleased to introduce our speaker for this evening, Trevor Van Dam. Trevor is a Canadian who he did his undergraduate work at the University of Victoria with honors in Greek and Roman studies. He then stayed on to do his MA in also in Greek and Roman studies. He has a knack, and I, as I like to point it out, for nice titles. His MA thesis was Remembering the Mycenaeans, How the Ancient Greeks Repurposed Their Prehistoric Past, and is now a Ph.D. candidate in the Cotsen Institute of Archaeology at the University of California, Los Angeles, and he will be defending his dissertation in June. So this is, we're looking forward to hearing that. Recently, he has been, last 2 years, in fact, he's been at the American School as a regular member, and then as an associate member. His PhD dissertation title is Life After the Palaces, Collapse, Consumption, and Resilience in the Postpalatial Aegean. He is well fellowshipped in scholarship. He is already, though, not finished with his doctoral dissertation. He has been writing papers for publication, both alone and with his colleagues at Allian, and that they are cover the gamut from evidence for silk industry to pottery, prehistoric pottery, to interconnections between this. He has been working at Ancient Allian, one of the projects that Brendan Burke is here, one of the two co-directors with Brian Burns, and our synergathis, Alexandra Khanami from the Thebes Epiria, for many years at Allian, trench supervisor, and also in the survey. And now, when we visit in the, generally speaking, in June, we see him in the pottery. In the pottery room near the site, going over the excellent pottery. It's very, very high quality pottery from the site. He has not only worked at Allian, he's also worked Mycenae, worked on material from Mycenae, ancient Mycenae, American School project there, and was an illustrator for a project in Cyprus. He has given many papers. He's come back from Toronto, gone to Toronto, and at the end of the month, surely they're going to Vancouver for the American Society for American Archaeology. So he's a young scholar who is quickly making a name for himself, and he is also he is a pottery person, but I don't hold that against him. He's a pottery person who also likes to draw some conclusions and speculate. And so this evening's talk is looking at a structure that we think we know, and we're going to find out whether Schliemann and Wace got it right, or maybe there's something else that could be. So, Trevor, please come forward, and we look forward to your teaching. Thank you.
Thank you, David. That was an appropriate introduction, because today I will talk about some pottery and speculate wildly. All right. So, around 1200 BC, the Greek mainland was divided into a series of polities that we collectively refer to as the Mycenaeans, after the eponymous site, Mycenae. These centers were defined by the construction of monumental architectural complexes, commonly referred to as palaces. Here. But also through the construction of Cyclopean fortifications, imported luxury goods often reworked into locally meaningful motifs or artifacts, frescoed wall paintings, and elaborate mortuary rituals. within the next couple of decades, all of these palatial complexes were in ruins, destroyed by violent conflagrations and never to be rebuilt. While the cause of these destructions is unknown, whether local uprisings, interpolity warfare, marauding sea peoples, Dorian invaders, or perhaps even Poseidon's horses themselves, that is to say, earthquakes, it is clear that the former system was soundly rejected by those who survived, and those who survived were many. Although there has been a tendency to view the post-palatial period, that is to say, the period from the end of the palaces around 1200 BC or a little later, down to around 1050 BC, as a period of decline and stagnation, new research is increasingly emphasizing the formative role of the post-palatial period in the rise of the later Greek polis. Indeed, the post-palatial period is increasingly seen as a time of innovation, experimentation, and mobility, both geographic and social. The site of Tiryns in the Argolid has become particularly dominant in such narratives. The cleanup and installation of Building T, in conjunction with the renewal of the post-palatial period altar, altar on the upper citadel, demonstrates the continuity of some administrative structures following the collapse of the palace system, as well as indicates a certain level of change. It is this dynamic interplay between the former Mycenaean palatial culture and the innovative elements that makes the post-palatial period both endlessly fascinating and frequently surviving, and frequently surprising. But is Tiryns unique in this regard, or can similar enduring community organization be seen at other sites as well? New excavations may produce new evidence, but so too can old excavations conducted long ago. My paper today re-examines the evidence from the granary, seen here, where the most recent excavations took place almost 100 years ago. As the name suggests, the structure has been widely viewed as a communal building for the storage of grain, used right up to the end of LH IIIC Middle, say around 1100 BC. My search for good data on the post-palatial structures, and in particularly domestic structures, led me to the granary about 2 years ago. A visit to the Mycenae archive in Cambridge this spring allowed me to re-examine Alan Wace's excavation diaries from 1920 and clarify a number of questions. Today I'll present the results of this visit, along with a reconsideration of Schliemann's original notebook from his 1876 campaign, when the granary was first partially uncovered. While I initially became interested in the granary because many of the finds seemed so ordinary that I became convinced it was just another post-palatial household, at least in its post-palatial phase, my reconsideration of all the relevant evidence supports the claim that the granary served a more specialized function, one that, I must concede, seems ritual in nature. But before I get ahead of myself, let's go back to the talk itself. My talk today will be divided into three approximately equal length parts. First, I'll briefly sketch out what exactly a post-palatial household looks like so that we can understand how the granary might differ from that model. The impetus for this research is, as David mentioned, my 10 years of ongoing work at the site of Elyon, as a member of the Eastern Boeotia Archaeological Project, a synergosia between the Canadian Institute in Greece and the Boeotian Ephorate, co-directed by Alexandra Harami, Brendan Burke, and Brian Burns. Second, I'll move on to discuss the excavation of the granary itself, as well as discuss the architecture. This will include a re-examination of the architectural features, as well as the stratigraphy of the site to better understand its function. Finally, I'm going to close today by contextualizing the granary, both within the wider post-palatial world, as well as within its architectural setting in the Mycenae Citadel. Okay. So, first, to orient ourselves, our primary evidence for well-preserved post-palatial households comes from Central Greece, and in fact, I'm going to mainly refer to three sites in my description of palatial households. The site of Elion in the East Boeotia, Lefkhandi in Western Evia, and the site of Kinos in East Locris. So, as I said, many people survived the collapse of the Mycenaean palaces. And indeed, at Elion, particularly in the northwest complex, we have good evidence for what households looked like after collapse. And one of the themes that I want to stress tonight is this idea of continuity, but with change. So even though we see continuity of various elements into the post-palatial period, it's also a time when we see a lot of changes integrated with brought in that modify those old ideas. So if we look at the architecture of Elion, we see palatial elements, but mixed in new ways and new configurations. So for instance, in the northwest structure, we have four columns surrounding a hearth, but no longer in a grand palatial setting, but in a rather ordinary space. We also see the use of a ramped entrance into this space that seems to mimic palatial architectural features seen at Gla. In addition, we find that roof tiles continue to be produced, at least at Elion, well into the 3C period. So we have evidence from the end of LH 3C early to suggest that there's still roofing structures. And you can see on the left here some presentation of what these roof tiles would have looked like in their intact form. And this comes from a palatial structure in Thebes. We also have cover tiles at Elion, not shown in this image. The same can be said for other material classes beyond architecture. So within the ceramic repertoire from Elion, we also see this same interaction between continuity and change. So we see the continuation of the use of kilikis for communal drinking, in addition to the use of transport stirrup jars, something that's been closely tied to palatial monitoring of their production. And yet at both Elion and at Lefkhandi, we seem to have locally produced instances of these well into an advanced LH3C early date. If we turn to Lefkhandi, households frequently preserve basement level rooms filled with storage. So you can see Pithoi here, you can see clay built installations here. And one of the hallmarks of post-palatial households is this sudden increase in visible storage compared to the palatial period. So much so that excavators have frequently characterized post-palatial households as communal buildings in their initial excavation, only to discover that, no, in fact, most houses preserve these large storerooms. So there's this idea that maybe there's some sort of either risk buffering activity going on, or maybe they're converting these staple goods into value-added goods. And we'll talk more about this in a second. These storage, as I said, you get well-fired pithoi and vats for storing goods, but you also get a lot of these low or unfired clay-built installations. So here you can see ones from Kinos and from Lefkhandi. And these can be quite large, so they can be up to a meter and 20 centimeters in diameter and say half a meter to a meter tall. At the upper end, some of these have over 300 liters of dry goods storage. So they can be, form a significant part of a household's storage capacity. In addition to large-scale storage, textile manufacture occurs in quite significant amounts. And we see two predominant forms of loom weight at this time, perhaps suggesting also variability in the types of cloth that are being produced. So we see these very large ring weights at both Elion and Lefkandi. And these are associated with the manufacture of very thick textiles, possibly something even along the lines of rugs. In addition, we have the ubiquitous spools. You know, there's a very large debate over whether spools are in fact used for weaving, but I think the Center for Textile Research has shown pretty compellingly that not only are they useful for weaving, they produce a very light open weave cloth, but if we look at the context in which they're found, we really have no choice but to accept that they really are used for weaving. And sometimes you find them in arrays as though being set up on a loom. So there's pretty strong contextual evidence that they are in fact being used for weaving. And speaking of contextual evidence, we can go and look at households such as Lefkandi, which in fact has rooms containing both spools as well as the ring weights. Or we could look at Kinos, where one room contained over 250 of these. So we're looking at production, assuming perhaps 20 to 40 spools per loom, that is in the neighborhood of 10 to 20 looms in this one house at Kinos. So not only do we have evidence for domestic production of textiles, but we really seem to have almost a textile industry, such a great production that they clearly must be trading it, whether locally or internationally. So, with that brief review of what a post-palatial household looks like then, I'd like to turn to the granary itself. The granary was first identified by Heinrich Schliemann in 1876, within the first couple of days of his large-scale excavation. And so this entry in his diary from August 10th is the first mention that can definitely be pinned to the granary. So we came today near the wall to the calcinated remnants of a large dwelling house. The fire must have raged fearfully, for even the stones of the Cyclopean wall had suffered greatly. Found were. And here you see one of Schliemann's typical entries in his diary of a long list of things that he found that day with little contextual information. So the preamble to this would lead us to believe that these finds are perhaps associated with the area above and among the ruins of the granary. But in this case, we can't exactly be sure. Certainly intriguing are the last three entries, millstones of lava, hydria, and three archaic vases, one of which is very wonderful. It is black. And there's a drawing of an upper part of a stirrup jar. When Schliemann uses the word archaic, he's generally referring to Bronze Age vases. He uses Hellenic for things that are clearly Greek, although sometimes he refers to geometric things as archaic, so it's a little dicey. Interestingly, all of these things were found by Wace in the ruins of the granary. So there's good reasons to think this probably came from above the granary as well. Schliemann himself published this print in his final report, which allows us to see the state of the granary at the end, or this is probably in the middle of his excavations. He probably picked at it a little more after. Schliemann was asked by the Greek government to leave a block of soil to aid in the anastylosis of blocks around the lying gate. And so he was forced to leave a chunk here, which he bemoans in his diary and says, "Everyone's going to think I left this a mess." I mean, irony. but one of the interesting things about this print is that it's actually based on a photo that survives. And this photo preserves a slightly better view of both the lying gate here, but also the strata that Schliemann uncovered. And if you see this person here for scale, you can see just how deep the deposit was above the granary at the time of its discovery. And indeed, in the close-up view, you can make out both the wash layers and topsoil, but also this thick white clay layer here, followed by the walls of the granary itself can just be made out over here. Another interesting thing to point out, of course, is the grave stelae, which are clearly visible here at a very high level, supporting Gates's reconstructed view of the replaced grave stelae in Grave Circle A. So that block of earth, which you could make out, is the same block of earth. Let's go back there for a second. So you can make out the, this is the, when you walk through the lion gate on your right, there's a small internal bastion that separates the gateway from the granary. And this is where Wace excavated the famous lion gate strata. So the first stratigraphic excavation. So this was very early on in Wace's career. It was 1920, but this was kind of the first rigorous application of a scientific method to understanding the ceramic sequence at Mycenae. And the strata extended over, presumably, the ruins of the granary as well, including these Greek remains, which we'll see later on. So here is the granary, as it can be seen today, fully excavated now. A couple of salient points can be derived from this image. One, of course, is the unusual feature that the granary is built right onto the Cyclopean wall. So even Schliemann noted this in his diaries. None of the other Mycenaean Cyclopean house foundations do this. And this is one of the reasons why Elizabeth French has suggested that the granary itself might be postpalatial, because this is a feature of postpalatial architecture at Mycenae, and is associated with perhaps a breakdown in centralized planning. But other features of the architecture make this view difficult to hold. So for one, everyone can clearly see this nick in the wall. Schliemann calls it the nick, it makes sense. This is all an addition. So originally, you had a rectangular structure, which is fairly compact, of one plan. Later, these two corridors were extended. So for one thing, we know this building was standing for some period of time that it underwent modifications. And thanks to Wace's careful observations of the floor levels, we know that there was a fire destruction in between those two levels. Wace doesn't record any significant deposits of pottery, so it seems to have been well cleaned out. But in a couple of places, including the corridors and in the bottom of the stairwell, he discerned that there had been evidence for this earlier phase. That's important because we have to find where that could have occurred. So here in this reconstruction by Pete DeYoung, you can see that original first phase of the architecture. So at this time, there's an unobstructed view of the from the Lion Gate into the Grave Circle. Presumably the entrance was here, but Wace could find no evidence of where the original entranceway was, but Occam's razor suggests that it was at the end of the north corridor, as it was later. One of the interesting things about the north corridor, of course, is its use of conglomerate elements at the entranceway. So both the anteblock and the threshold that are preserved are of conglomerate. And of course, this is an architectural syntax or vocabulary that derives from the palatial period. Assuming that these were moved from the original entrance then, we might suggest that the first phase of this building was, in fact, in the palatial period at LH3B2. The architecture itself is still incredibly well preserved even today. So we can still make out not only the basement rooms, but the rooms for the whole plan of the ground floor rooms as well. And as we'll discuss, it seems pretty clear that there must have also been a first floor. So this was a very impressive structure in its own right, no doubt aided by its position being built against the Cyclopean wall. But it's a rare case, if it is reused from the palatial period, of architecture that was actually reused after the massive 3B2 destruction at Mycenae. In most other places, of course, there was leveling, the level was raised, and the 3C architecture was built above the ruins. So the fact that this would have been cleared out also suggests perhaps there was some sort of importance attached to this building. And here you can make out the window into the stairwell. Again, this is a feature of palatial architecture, but it's not something that we have any evidence of in the post-palatial period. And similarly, you can see the south wall and the massive footing that was built to retain the structure. If you're familiar with Grave Circle A, all the graves to the west, where the shaft graves are located, are much deeper than the bedrock shelf to the east. And the granary lies right on this junction between the increase in the bedrock and the depths of the bedrock. So it needed a particularly stable southwestern corner to support the entire structure. So while Wace himself didn't identify any remains of the earlier structure, it's tempting to connect two LH3C early pots that were found by Wace on floor levels, or perhaps, in my view, slightly under floor levels, that may actually date from that destruction in between the reconstruction. And if this is correct, then we could connect this maybe with the end of, say, phase 8 in the rest of the British excavations. And if that's true, it provides an impetus for that extension of the corridors. And so, just to remind you of this being built on after. By re-examining Wace's stratigraphy, a pretty clear view of the different floor levels can be ascertained. So in this image, we see some red roof tiles denoting the Greek remains, a Hellenistic household that extended over part of it. Schliemann even could observe that there were Hellenistic house remains here that he dug through quickly. Beneath those, Wace observed large Cyclopean blocks falling from the wall. So this provided the end date for any use of the structure itself. Anything beneath those presumably derived from the actual use phase of the granary. And immediately below there, he found first a layer of spools, which included some mendable fineware vessels, including this wavy band crater. Elizabeth French thought that this might actually be later than the granary, but in Lefkandi phase 2b, such wavy band craters with linear interiors already occur, so there's nothing about the date that prevents it from being associated with the granary. Going down further, Wace began to find the remains of unbaked Cotseles. He's in fact the one who first termed them Cotseles, because workmen said that they still had things like this in their houses at that time, which were just clay-built installations to hold grain from the harvest. Wace found quite a few fragments of these and thankfully quantified them. So we know approximately the size and height of these Cotseles. He also found remains of two pithoi in this fall. And among the Cotseles is this famous close-style stirrup jar. So presumably deriving from that ground floor level. Falling deep to the floor level, there were still some fragments of the Cotseles. A couple of schools seem to have escaped down, and a couple of broken millstones, perhaps deriving from higher levels as well. But most importantly, Wace found pots clustered along the walls in what he called nests. These include some clove shapes, hydrae, amphorae, but also a lot of fineware shapes, including a mix of the so-called granary style on the left and the clove style on the right. And it is legendarily Wace who first realized that these two styles were in fact chronologically the same. But in reading Schliemann's notebook, Schliemann makes the same observation on the west basement, namely that the vases with pretty swans and antelopes painted on them were chronologically identical to the vases with linear decoration. And so the credit has to go to Schliemann for first identifying that these were synchronous styles. So basically, we can envision a collapse scenario where material from these upper floors got dragged all the way to the bottom, which seems to be the case with the spools, which were encountered very high up in all the rooms. And indeed, spools were found also spilled over into the corridors, which suggests, therefore, that the spools actually originate on a floor above these. So if we look at a tentative reconstruction of this, we can see the locations of these nests of pots, which seem to derive perhaps from shelves built along a low bench in the east basement. Then we have the ground floor, which contains storerooms. And Schliemann seems to have observed a similar stratigraphy, although he doesn't mention the Cotseles. The first floor, we obviously don't have a lot of solid evidence for. It's questionable whether or not this staircase would have continued. Otherwise, functionally, this staircase would not have made much sense. So perhaps what we're actually dealing with is a relatively small first floor structure with a large open area on which activities are being carried out, like grinding grain and weaving. So I mentioned Schliemann found similar stratigraphy in the west. Most salient here are August 31st and September 1st, when we know he's just digging out the west basement. And in it, he finds lots of figurines. He finds the remnants of animal bones. Schliemann initially calls this the Cyclopean house. Then he becomes convinced he's digging a tomb, and then goes back to it being a house. But then he thought the corridors were cisterns. So he had a lot of ideas about this architecture because it was so unique. On August 31st, he also encountered for the first time wheat and vetches, much like we saw with Wace. So coming down in the basement, he starts to encounter the wheat and vetch. But on September 1st, he seems to have dug below the wheat and vetch. And so what he finds there are spindle whorls, but mostly just pottery. So it seems like perhaps the western half of the structure followed the same basic plan. That is to say, if we go back here, that there were storage containers on a ground floor, and then the basement was reserved for the storage of ceramics. All right. So if we want to compare the granary then to some domestic structures, we can do so. So considering the number of spools from the granary, we can look at the number of potential looms. And what we find is, in fact, the granary is not so special. It fits the model of a pretty self-sufficient household, i.e. one or two looms, but nothing excessive. Nothing, say, like a Kinos or a Lefkandi house, where there's clearly textiles being produced in excess. If we look at storage, we find the same thing. Yeah, the granary has a moderate level of storage, but this is actually pretty much at subsistence level. Of course, you could say we're missing the evidence from Schliemann's excavation, okay, in which case we might double it, and it's on the nature of some of the upper end of households. But again, it's nothing extreme beyond what we would expect. So finally, what if we look at the ceramic assemblage? Well, in this case, we see the granary shoots up beyond a typical household. There are a lot of pots, even just in, and keep in mind, these were excavated over 100 years ago, so we're not getting a lot of vessels that weren't immediately recognizable here. Wace talks about large quantities of other sherds that were not kept. So, you know, if someone had carefully gone through a lot of this stuff, there definitely were more vases. And Schliemann made no effort to mend things that weren't of interest to him. So we lost a lot of vessels also from that part of the building. So this number is a very minimum. And on account of that, I wanted to see, okay, maybe we'll look at ceramic diversity to try to counter some of that effect. But what we see when we look at ceramic diversity is actually that the granary is less diverse than some households. So there are actually fewer different kinds of activities going on there. So what is going on there? Well, we can look at the difference between, say, open and closed shapes, and we find that over 90% of the pottery in the granary are open shapes. And among those, the most common things are things that have to do with either dining or, in particular, drinking. And obviously, things like deep bowls are common, sure, and there were probably many more. Of particular interest is a cluster of calathoi, a shape that's relatively rare in settlement contexts, but maybe is used for hand washing. Ask me and Bartek about that later. But the predominant shape is what I'm calling the three handlers, and these are either cups or goblets with three handles. And these are fairly rare. They're not something you find every day on an excavation. So what's going on? Here are the three handlers. So you can see they come in more of a cuppy form, but also in a stemmy form that is more of a goblet type. So these have been found across both mainland Greece and also at Philakopi. And so I just briefly wanted to go over the find spots of these to drive home the uniqueness of them. So first we can go to Parati, and in tomb 59, located right in the heart of the cemetery, dating to Parati phase 2, we find that there is one of these vessels in the entire cemetery of 192 looms. And it was found carefully placed by the head of one of the deceased, where it was crushed when the ceiling fell down. Thankfully, this is one of the few tombs that was built over by other tombs, so we have a pretty good handle on the stratigraphy. And so this can be placed, actually basically contemporary with the granary vessels in 3C middle. If we go up north, if we go to the site of Pefkakia, one of these three handlers has recently been found in what is called a workshop context. This workshop features a bench and a large hearth, as well as a buried vessel. Yeah, that was buried at floor level, but meant to be opened up and presumably put stuff in it. And here you can see from the original excavation, bones and sherd scattered all about this workbench. So, of course, it doesn't really matter if this is a workshop or not. Things like figurines and a conical cup make it clear that there's some sort of casual ritual activity at the very least going on at this spot. And of course, workshops are often associated with some sort of cultic activity. One only needs to think of the potter's quarter ekrabati, for instance. Moving on to Me True, Salvatore Vitale has published a pottery of LH IIIC material from this corner right here, in which another three handler was found. And this is the earliest three handler we know of. And it was associated with other pottery for communal eating and drinking. It was also associated with various strange types of shells. So in some sort of deposit that clearly is ritualized in behavior. Moving on to the more clearly defined architecture, we have the sanctuary at Philakopi, where there were two three handlers found, which Penelope Mountjoy published as craters. They're about 20 centimeters wide, so they're, you know, a big deep bowl size, but, you know, they clearly have stems and were meant to have large feet. So they're kind of like a weird stem bowl with big handles. These are the largest version, but given their setting within an actual architectural shrine, it's perhaps unsurprising that we're finding a more elaborate version of the ceramic vessel. And one of these comes from just outside the shrine, perhaps where it was actually employed in ritualized dining, and one was found just inside. And this one's interesting because it's the only example that we have that is painted. Finally, we end our tour at Iceni, which brings us back to the Argolid itself. The room 32 of House G has long been held as an example of either a domestic shrine or perhaps not a domestic shrine, depending who you ask. It has all the hallmarks of an Aegean cult site, a nice bench, a wide array of pottery, a buried jug for receiving libations, which sounds a lot like Pathkapya. We have a calathos, so if you feel like the calathos is for hand washing, it's right there. And lots of figurines, including the head known as the Lord of Iceni, but also a kylix, a very late example of the kylix being employed in cult, so here in the LH3C late context, and a three handler, now in cup form. So, one of the neat things about this review, beyond showing without a doubt that this shape occurs predominantly in what we would either call ritual or ritualized contexts, is that we can actually now reconstruct the development of the shape, if that interests you at all. And we really do see the shrinking away of the stem. And of course, it's interesting to note that this boundary really occurs between 3C middle and 3C late when we see the kylix disappear from ritualized dining overall in the Mycenaean world. So there seems to have been an attempt to get this away from its original kylix-y shape so it could still be used in cultic settings, which I find interesting. Beyond that, we have the interesting occurrence of an anthropomorphic vase within the granary. So this was found in the stairwell, presumably fallen from above as well. And intriguingly, tantalizingly, Schliemann, again, it's unclear if he's referring to things found in the granary or in Grave Circle A, but certainly within that vicinity, talks about a similar anthropomorphic vase, saying in the middle of the skull there's always a round hole, also implying that he's found multiple of these. The necks are always richly ornamented with necklaces, and these things were evidently the handles of vases. And if I can show you the back side of this, there's a scar for a handle. So this was the handle of a jug with a human head and that was used for pouring libation. So we clearly have something cultic going on here. Something that looks a little bit like an anthropomorphic vase from the cult center. Okay, so here's where I venture dangerously into the realm of speculation. So pulling back, we can consider the context of the granary at large. Of course, the elephant in the room is Grave Circle A in its monumentalized form, which dictates both the shape and location of the granary. Of course, one can't help but notice that the cult center lies in the similar position on the opposite side of the grave circle. And cult center, as you all are aware. So it's clear that the grave circle once dominated this area. And as Charles Gates convincingly shows, Grave Circle A was restored at some point during LH III. It's difficult to place with great precision, but probably sometime in LH IIIB, perhaps when it's enclosed by the Cyclopean wall. And it's assumed, well, so at this time, obviously, the enclosure wall is built, but the question is this also the time when the stelae are lifted? And probably it is. People could still find the stelae. Certain stelae and fragments of them were left at the lower level, and Schliemann observed that correctly, a number of features that were much deeper down. And I showed you the picture, of course, from Schliemann's actual excavations that demonstrate very clearly there were stelae erected at that higher level. So what's going on? Well, in this regard, it's interesting to think of how late people were interacting with the grave circle. Schliemann makes a couple of important observations. Around those grave stelae, he points out that he's finding a lot of burnt animal bone and a lot of ash. And in addition, one might consider the 700 plus figurines Schliemann found in the area of Grave Circle A and the granary. Of course, many of these were broken or discards, but it's important to note that even the British excavations of an equally large area right adjacent to this, they found a drop in the bucket compared to that. So there clearly was intentional deposition of figurines in that area. And there clearly were many fragments of figurines recovered from the granary itself. Even just in Wace's work there, he found almost 50. So combined with what Schliemann found, there was a significant quantity within it. So thinking of the painted grave stelae then, of course, this seems to demonstrate that at least in LH3C middle, people were still able to find fragments of these grave stelae. Now, the painted grave stelae is very interesting because it was reused as the blocking for an intrusive tomb in Tsuntas Chamber Tomb 70. And if you don't know where that is, it's nowhere near the Acropolis. So this thing was taken from the grave circle at some point, dragged all the way over here, and used as a blocking wall in a tomb. We don't know when it was painted. Was it for that blocking wall? Or was it painted where it originally stood in the grave circle? One thing that, of course, would suggest that maybe its painted decoration has to do with the grave circle is, of course, the fact that it iconographically mirrors our friend, the warrior base, which was found, of course, adjacent to the grave circle. If these were part of some sort of iconographic program oriented around the grave circle, it seems that it has to do with a Mycenaean mourning custom to lift the title of Jacobides' paper about tombs from Karati. The warrior base itself was first correctly interpreted as a Mycenaean mourning scene by none other than Brendan Burke in the front row here. So, if that's the case, we have to ask ourselves, what does this all mean? If the granary is indeed a ritual structure, what are they doing with it? The fact that there's this evidence for weaving and grain grinding and feasting activities, combined with the evidence from the grave circle itself that there is detritus from such activities, it's interesting to note that, of course, rather than actually block off the grave circle A at the end of in its second phase, the granary comes to dominate access to the grave circle, and it seems to share an intimate relationship with them. One that I might suggest is oriented either around the incipient beginnings of hero cult, or perhaps even related to funerary rituals taking place before bodies were carried out of the citadel for burial in chamber tombs outside. And maybe even one of these stelae at some point was taken after dining in the grave circle and used to block up the chamber tomb with the dead. That I'm going to end on that widely speculative note. Thank you.
Something for the pottery folks and for the speculators. Who has a comment or question to start this off? There must be. I have one. Maybe you just missed it. The earliest phase of this so-called granary.
Yeah.
Is it certainly before 3C? Could it be?
There is nothing certain about that date. Based off of, here's all we know. We know it's built later than the Cyclopean wall and whatever modifications took place to Grave Circle A, based off of the footings of that base, that large terrace that holds up the rest of the granary. Just on a purely architectural analysis of those remains, the scale of the structure itself, and the fact that it reuses those conglomerate elements later, which, if they are correctly interpreted as the original entrance to the building, would suggest that it was built in the palatial period. But there are a lot of ifs and buts there. It also requires you accepting that those couple of miscreant pottery pieces are, in fact, from the earlier destruction, which took place in LH 3C early. Lisa French puts it in the post-palatial period because it's attached to the wall. And that's still not explained. If you put it in the palatial period, it's really weird that it's attached to the wall.
Okay, but the use of the conglomerate could be, these were stones lying about.
They obviously reused them anyway in the post-palatial phase. Right. I'm arguing there's like a little religious conservatism there, which is why they also empty out the building.
Okay, but it's
whereas
still,
they don't do
still possible that these were ways of trying to connect the building to the past and do it in a very economical way.
Of course.
Just where the entrance, where it makes the most sense.
Most bang, yeah. But we can't actually say.
We can't, okay. We'll let that. Yes.
Hey, Trevor. Thanks for your talk. Even though I would normally fall more into the speculative camp on this, I actually have a pottery question for you.
Sure.
Do you see your three handlers as in their kind of evolution as possibly morphing eventually into like the footed skiffos of the proto-geometric period? And if so, do you have material from that period that might fit that at any of these sites where your three handlers appear?
No. I wouldn't say so. No, their three handler is really, it's an interesting shape because it's particularly rare. I mean, one could make the argument that it actually only starts in the palatial period, which then is another interesting thing. If it's a palatial ritual item that somehow gets like taken back by the people. My answer to this is that, in fact, what we're seeing is a strong religious conservatism, which is they want to keep using this three-handled shape, and so the modifications that take place to that shape don't affect the most meaningful element, which is that it has three handles and it's a drinking vessel. But they can get rid of that annoying kylix stem because we don't like the kylix anymore because that's associated with the palace.
Yeah, I guess I was thinking more in terms of the using the stem as opposed to the handles. Thanks.
Comments? Questions? Pushback? What else? Just to refresh my memory about the 12th century. What other buildings do you have that date to the 12th century in the citadel?
Oh, and Mycenae. So, like, I don't know. mean, there are lots of buildings from the British excavations. Everywhere else around there, they were dug away. were actually constructed at that date, or continued in years?
After the destruction of the palace. 3C, early...
You have some structures built above the cult center area, which, if you ask the Brits, still have kind of a culty function. Mm. If you ask me, look a lot like houses.
So there are other, the citadel, unlike at Tiryns, the structure T is the only structure in the altar.
Then they don't live
inside the walls. The rest is left
out. Yeah. I mean, they seem to actually build houses, everyday houses, inside the citadel after it, Mycenae. I mean, there's some evidence that 3C early, at least, they're still living outside. Trinovitu has been excavating, you know, the west, or the east house area near the west house, and she has some 3C middle material. So, I mean, they didn't completely abandon the lower city, but yeah, more people seem to have moved into the citadel as well. More crowded, probably, but, you know, we lost a lot, so difficult to be exactly sure.
Hard to compare the two sites.
Yeah.
Questions? Yes.
Thank you very much. It was a really great talk. I'm curious about the following fact. So we have in total 7 tree handlers, right? 2 from Lycopene, 5 from other sites. Always, except for Barati, from either ritual dining or communal dining with, okay, here's to the gods type of context.
Yeah.
And of course, the funerary one from Barati. So, these 7, of course, then it begs the question, why on earth we have this weird shape and all these funerary slash shrine slash communal ritual eating contexts. And assuming that, of course, it's not the little crazy nut job apprentice's little experiment fault, Yanis, what did you do? We didn't need a third one type of thing. What would be the functional reason for these? Because usually when you have in like world pottery, as far as I know, when you have three-handled cups, it's usually 2 for big shapes, of course, 2 for carrying and 1 for pouring. This is a small drinking open shape. Mm-hmm. Why on earth would you need a third handle? I mean, you're a ceramicist by trade, and my condolences for that, but you must have thought about the functional reason for it. Could you find any?
So, the general consensus, and I think it actually does make practical sense, is think back to the context you describe, which is a communal setting. And the idea is that they're being shared. And so what better way to share something is you have that third handle. So if you're holding 2 of them, the other person can take it from you and still have the support of at least 1 handle in that handoff. And it does actually kind of make sense. You have something on all sides that you can get a grip on.
But I mean, don't they make the same argument for the appearance of the double-handled shapes, even like in Bronze Age 3? So we have the double-handled shapes because drinking culture changes, you just hand the vessel to the other dude type of thing?
I mean, on a kylix or something like this, it's not a big enough handle that you're actually grabbing it, though, right? Like, you're not going to lift a kylix up by that little stub. It's more of like almost a lug handle at this point. They're so diminutive that you can't hold, especially those big ones from the Lacopi. You're not going to grab one of those with the vessel full. It's just not going to work.
Yeah.
So it still seems the best explanation is that it has to do with circulating them during the drinking activities. But that still begs the question, why do you have 44 at Mycenae when apparently 1 or 2 can do at a lot of these other clearly ritual areas? I mean, so Schliemann, in another day, describes digging further in a tomb, which I think he's referring again to have dug even deeper into the west basement, and he says that he found a bunch of pottery and a bunch of intact vessels, including goblets, and it's tempting to think that they were also storing a bunch in the west basement, which then asks how many total were. Because Wace refers to other ones, he threw away all the ones that weren't complete because there were just so many fragments of them. So, yeah, this is, it's a very weird deposit of copy.
Yeah, like a very miniature follow-up, yeah. An unrelated though. So, so far I knew that this was the 3C granary, and it was like, oh, look at this, like communal storage is happening, type of things when I was talking to ignorant undergrad. So, after this talk, never do that again. So, your chart was amazing in the sense that you look at the textile production activity, it's actually nothing more than one would expect for a level of self-sufficiency.
Yeah.
And then you show the another chart with grain storage. It's again something that you would expect from a household.
Yeah.
But then we have the ritual activity thing. So do you think that this was the house of a priest or a priestly family? Now I'm going to be speculative following your example. Are we looking at a religious establishment with its residential angle, you think, or it's just a normal household which occasionally was the scene of some ritual activity too?
Yeah, I mean, you could try to look at it a model where there's like one person living in there and kind of dominating the activity, but I don't think it works, mainly because of the architecture of the structure. I mean, unless that unknown third floor was some sort of domestic quarters, which doesn't really seem likely, I'm inclined more towards the workspace based off of the finds that seem to be associated with the top floor. There's just nowhere for people to actually live in the structure. It's very small. So one of the graphs I didn't show you is a comparison of the total area, because for houses, we barely have enough that are fully excavated to really make a strong argument based off of total area of the households. But you would see that the granary, the total area is small. It's expanded by having multiple floors, but they're mostly small, dark, kind of dingy chambers for storing things. And then if you had a more open upper floor, you would have a workspace. So I don't think people were actually living in it. I think it was a communal structure of some sort. But
I think that upper floor, though, you have a view of the grave circle.
You do, yes.
And you could probably look over the wall.
You could see out to the cemetery.
So
well.
Maybe more of a performative aspect of the workshop.
You're arguing for it's a more than less domestic, more ritual, which comes to me, what is the weaving doing here? What is the purpose of weaving there? Bringing textiles in, okay, but we have no evidence. But if you're actually making, what is the purpose in this context of on-site weaving?
I mean, one could speculate wildly about multiple things. It is associated with contemporary funeral rituals before, you know, it's like dining before you take people out or bury him, some sort of communal event about the burying of an individual. If we imagine there's some sort of, like, I don't know, mechanism for creating a sense of social equality in the postpalatial period, maybe it's a communal pressure to dine together and then you take the dead person.
Why are you weeping?
Burial shrouds, that's what I'm getting at.
Shrouds, or
something, if that nature. If you think the ritual is more focused on heroic cult, then it's, you know, some sort of cloth dedication. If you want to say that this is a communal building and, you know, there you need to provide revenue somehow as well, there could be the option of, you've got to make some money somehow. But I think that the quantity is so small, it's probably for internal use of whatever the structure is.
But if it's a ritual structure, is anybody living there? You seem to suggest that they are.
They do work.
So it has something. Okay.
It's complicated.
It's complicated. The way to have a movie on that. other questions? Okay. One final point is that about the three-handle shape, as I seem to recall, probably from Edwardian Victorian, they used to have sterling silver vessels, which were called loving cups. And if I recall correctly, for ritual drinking activities, that these were three-handlers. In other words, the idea of passing around, everybody taking it so the next person as a purchase on the vessel. So maybe, I think if you looked up, you know, the loving cups, I think they have this kind of, again, like a punch bowl.
Yeah.
But they're not huge, but they're not small either for communal drinking activity.
That's great.
Anyway, thank you very much. We had nice pottery. We had a very veritable tour of sites that many of us have not seen in situ, at least under excavation. And we've made us think a little bit more about the 12th century, which I think is one of the most important centuries of the Bronze Age world, or post-Bronze Age world, so that we're now going to go home and try to put all this together. And next time they see you, we'll say, but have you thought of it? Anyway, thank you very much.